for our communion meditation.
Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Those of you at home watching or that's not here, if you want to get your elements ready, we'll be taking those in just a minute. Here lately, I've been spending a lot of time traveling in and out of town, and sometimes I do lots of stuff, and most of the time I just sit around thinking about useless knowledge. But sometimes constructive thoughts, sometimes productive stuff, sometimes not at all. Sometimes you think about things that are totally useless, that, you know, the number of people older than me will never increase. If you rip a hole in a net, you have less holes than what you started with. Is there a metric time system? Would Lightning McQueen need car insurance or life insurance? You know, just useless random things. These questions or thoughts will never solve major issues or change the world or even be remembered a week from now. Sometimes I wonder how the disciples remembered Christ. I imagine for the rest of their lives, every time they broke bread or took of the cup, they were flooded with memories and emotions. The memories of healings, the memories of miracles, the memory of the casting of demons, the teachings of the Father, Jesus serving them by washing their feet, their memories of his instructions, his promises, his miserable death, his magnificent resurrection, and his ascension. This adds so much more to the line, "Do this in remembrance of me." So how do you personally remember Jesus? We take this bread and the cup, truly do this in remembrance of him. Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread and broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after saying, "This cup of the new covenant is my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's have a prayer. Father, we are grateful to be in your house this morning. We're thankful for the many blessings you put in our life, the big ones, the small ones, the ones we don't recognize, the ones we take for granted. We do this in remembrance of Jesus and the precious gift that he gave to us. He paid the price for our sins. And we thank you for everything you've done. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. Let's stand to our feet and worship our Lord and Savior this morning.
Thank you.
foyer if you'd like to fill one of those out. As always, you can check out all of our announcements and about anything that's going on here, any cancellations or postponements. You can check that out on our website at mycccclife.com. You can also check that out on our Facebook page at Canton Christian Church. Unashamed is meeting on Mondays, and it is from 6:30 to 7:30. Dinner is included. That's our pre-teens group from ages 8 to about 15, and it meets over in the church basement. Life group, we typically meet on Wednesdays in the church basement, but we got something different going on this week, and we are actually going. So how many of you have seen the series The Chosen? Anybody seen the series The Chosen? Really good series out there, and they have a premiere down at the theater on Charleston Road on Wednesday evening, and it's the Christmas story with the actors and the group that's doing The Chosen. We are actually going to go see that. Anybody that would like to go, Karen, how many tickets you say we have? We got 5 tickets left, so if the church is picking up the ticket, you're going to have to buy your own popcorn, sorry.
It's all reserved, so it's sold out. Yeah. So you can't come in and get tickets, but I got about 5 left.
So we've got 5 there, so if anyone wants to go, you know, church is paying the way on that. We're going to head down there. If you need a ride, get with us. I'm sure some of us can give you a ride down there. But it ought to be a really good time. So that's Wednesday night. And what time is the premiere? It starts at 7, so we need to leave here by 6 anyway. So if anybody wants to have a ride or anything, you can get with me, get with Karen, and we'll arrange a ride, and everybody can meet together with the caravan down there. So, and any info on that, you can see Karen or Keith, and they'll hook you right up. Helping Hearts is holding the fundraiser still with the Rada products, the knives, kitchen utensils, Terry Lynn products, the nuts, the chocolates, trail mixes. All of those can be found over here in the foyer and the catalogs. All orders are due by December 5th. And folks, I don't know if you know this, but we are on the heels of December right now. So it's not very long. So that basically next Sunday, we need your orders by next Sunday. Is that correct? So if you could get those turned in, that way we can get them here by Christmas. That would be awesome. And if you got any questions about that, you can see Colton for that. Also, we are still having a cereal and canned soup drive for the food bank. That's going to continue over the next couple of weeks here. If you want to go out and if you're shopping, you want to support that ministry, you can bring those here to the church. We'll see that they get to the food bank and kind of help them out through this season also. Any other announcements that I've missed this morning?
Yes, the Helping Hearts are going to do the baskets again this year, food baskets for those people that need it. If you know of anybody, please give me your names. Instead of doing a week-by-week thing, if you want to just bring your stuff and drop it off, that's fine.
Okay.
We will be delivering them on the 19th of December. So you have the 19th to get stuff here.
Fantastic. Fantastic. So if you'd like to support that ministry, see Holly, see Colton. They can hook you up with whatever they're going to need for those baskets. I know that those baskets are a true blessing to those that need it most. So any other announcements here this morning? That's a good question. It's coming up here soon. Are you preparing already? Is that it?
I want to get
it up. You want to get it up? Okay. All right. We usually do it somewhere. We usually do that somewhere around the 15th, so not next Sunday, but a couple of Sundays away. We're probably looking at that also. So any other announcements this morning? How about prayer requests? I know we've had a lot of people in the prayer list. I want to ask that we continue to pray for our brother Lee. Lee Combs is living with his son and daughter-in-law right now. I talked to him a little earlier this week. Keith, Karen, I know you talked to him a little bit last week. He did seem to be just a teeny little bit better. So maybe we'll just keep our fingers crossed, keep praying. Maybe we can sneak him out here for a Christmas service or something like that. We'll see what we can do. And speaking of which, so I know this sounds premature, but it's not. We're only a few weeks away. We will have our Christmas Eve service. That will be in the sanctuary. Now, Christmas falls on a Saturday this year. So that Christmas Eve service will be Friday evening. It's a candlelight service. And it will be over in the sanctuary, as I said, and we will have cookies and some things afterwards. Is that correct, Karen? We're going to
Yes.
try to have a little bit of fellowship in the basement of the church afterwards. So kind of start writing that into your calendar and planning that along. It's a very good service, very intimate service. It's one of my favorite all throughout the year. And on Christmas, for our Christmas service here at the church, we're actually going to have two of them because of the way Christmas falls on a Saturday. We're going to celebrate on the 19th and on the 26th. And somebody had made that suggestion, and I thought, boy, you know, we can't celebrate the birth of Christ enough, so let's just do the two Sundays. So those two Sundays will be our Christmas Sundays here at the church also. So any other announcements this morning? Prayer requests? Any other GSF?
Bill Berry.
Okay. Keep filling our prayers this morning in Jesus' name. Any others this morning? Unspoken requests? I know we have unspoken requests. Be praying for those. If you would, I'm going to ask Jeff, would you lead our hearts in prayer at the end of the song?
Thank you.
thank you for your amazing grace, for all that you do, for your Son who willingly gave himself on the cross. We, as we gather around this table of remembrance and taking of these emblems to remind us of the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf of all who believe and follow him, and also that he overcame death and he rose again. We have that hope of life after death. Father, we thank you for all the blessings and life that you give us and for all that you do for us from day to day. Thank you for this place that we come together. We pray that all that we say and do will glorify and honor you. Father, I ask that you would be with those that mentioned our sick list, especially Brother Lee and Sandy and others that weren't mentioned, but we know there are many and we know that you know who they are. We lift them up to you and ask your healing hand upon them. Father, we thank you for all the young people who attend here and for the leaders that they will inspire the word of Jesus in their hearts and they will grow to be followers of yours. Father, we ask that you be with the Tony to bring the message that will enlighten us and strengthen and give us hope and strengthen your word and we will all grow stronger and be able to show Jesus in our lives. Father, forgive us those times we are weak and guide us in all that we do. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's just remain standing this morning as we continue with our worship.
Thank you.
shepherd what was about to happen on that Christmas morning, that they replied, glory in the highest, glory in the highest. This morning, as we begin our Christmas season, we begin by proclaiming glory in the highest. Sing with me this morning.
Thank you.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
You know, I don't know about you, but one of the things that I despise the most in life is having to wait. I hate to have to wait. I mean, everywhere we go today, everything we do today, it seems like we're caught in this dynamic of waiting. I mean, over and over again. And you know what this is like? You go to the doctor's office, they give you a form, you fill out a form, and you're told to sit down and wait. And depending on how many people's in there, how busy the doc is, that wait may be a short wait, it may be a long wait. You know, if we order something from Amazon, we go on there, we pick it out, we order it, and then we wait. We wait for that package to be delivered. Sometimes it's delivered, sometimes it doesn't get delivered. You know, we have that time of waiting. Go to the restaurant. I don't know if this has ever happened to you. Go to the restaurant, one of the first things I ask when we go up there is, how long is the wait? You know, and if it's 30 minutes or less, usually we'll stay there and we'll wait because we know if we go somewhere else, we're going to probably have to wait longer. So one of the things I don't like about life is this dynamic of waiting. None of us like to wait. But when it comes to this New Testament chapter of God's great love story, or the story of redemption, we associate with the term of patience, or the term of waiting. And we see this all the time in our relationship with our Heavenly Father. We ask, you know, God, why don't you heal this person? Or why don't you fix this? Or why don't you fix that? Why don't you stop him or her? Why didn't you do that? When are you going to do something about this, God? Or when are you going to come back to her? And here we are left, we're just waiting. And the good news is that if that dynamic bothers you today, you're not the first person that's ever bothered. We're not the first Christians to ever be frustrated by this dynamic of just waiting. Because when Jesus was on the earth, there was this moment that happened right after the resurrection. Jesus had been crucified on the cross, buried in the grave, and he was resurrected from the dead. And after this moment, he gathers all of his followers, he gathers his disciples together, and they say to him exactly what you and I might say if we were in their shoes. It kind of went like this, you know, hey, Jesus, you know, we've been following you for a long time, and we understand those promises of Abraham. We understand Moses and the law. We get all that. We understand, you know, the kingdom and that David's promise, you know, from David's line, there will come a kingdom that will never end. And we even understand the exile, even though we didn't like that period of time. We understand the exile. And then there was this 400 years of just waiting. No word from you, God. No nothing from you, God. Just waiting. Just waiting. So Jesus, we're your disciples here, and we understand all that. We get all that. But is now the time when you're going to restore the kingdom of Israel? Is now the time when you're going to proclaim yourself as king? I mean, is it the time? Because as best as we can tell, from the Old Testament, everything that needed to happen, all those promises, all those prophecies, they've been fulfilled. So is now the time? Is this it? And I don't know about you, but that seems like a reasonable question to me. I think if I was probably one of Jesus' disciples, I would have maybe been asking the same thing. But Jesus answers them and says, no. No, there's something else that has to happen. And I can imagine that this was so confusing and so frustrating for those early followers of Jesus. I mean, they had got everything that we've been talking about for the last 4 or 5 weeks here in church. They understood all of these promises of God, all these covenants of God, all these prophecies of God, all these prophets that came along, the good kings, the bad kings, the people talking about Messiah. Now, here Jesus, here you are. You're the fulfillment of all of that. It seems like everything that we've talked about is complete. What are we waiting on? You're telling us there's something else. And Jesus, he reveals to these first century followers something that is just truly amazing. He ends up revealing us to them. If you have your Bibles and you'd like to follow along today, we're going to Matthew 16. And this is a story where Jesus announces this next chapter of redemption in God's great love story. He begins by asking some questions. And these are some very interesting questions. Check this out. He asks, Matthew 16, verse 13 says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who, and it's interesting that he says who and not what. Because if he had said what, I know that that would lead them into saying, well, you're the Messiah that was prophesied for. But he says, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. In other words, Jesus, for the ones that don't know you, they think that maybe you're one of the prophets, you know, maybe Jeremiah, maybe Elijah reincarnated. Or at the very least, Jesus, they believe that you're someone who is like them, which is really interesting to me. Because I don't know if you know this or not, but when it comes to the religion of Islam, within the Quran, they talk about Jesus. But they believe Jesus to only have been a prophet, not a Messiah, not the Son of God. He was a prophet to them. And in this period of time, there was obviously some of those people out there that thought the very same way. Well, he must be another prophet that showed up, even though we haven't had one for 400 years. Jesus must be another prophet. Verse 15, Jesus changes the question, the dynamic a little bit. He says, but what about you? He asks. Who do you say I am? Simon Peter, of course, Simon Peter would be the one to answer because he was always the one to jump forward first. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replies to him, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. In other words, he's saying there was some divine inspiration in this. This is not something that you come up with on your own. This is something that the Lord has given you, that you've understood this tiny, tiny, tiny piece of what is going on. But what Jesus says next probably really, really confused them. Verse 18. He says, and I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build mine. He uses this word here, church, and the Greek word for this word church is ekklesia. And ekklesia is literally a following or a gathering of people. It's more than just like, not like a follower on Facebook. But like someone who is dedicated to the point that you're a disciple of them. You're gathering and you're a follower of Jesus Christ. He said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not overcome it. And that had to be confusing. It's still confusing for some of us today. You know, Jesus gets to this word church and they're thinking, church, I don't understand that what you're saying here, Jesus. Family, we get that. You know, kingdom, we get that. You know, that the 12 of us, we understand that. You know, we understand that there is a kingdom to come and that you're going to be the king of that. But what's this church? What's this gathering of faithful followers that you're talking about? And I imagine that the disciples had to be like, no, Jesus, you can't do that. That's not what we expected. That's not what we wanted. You're a king. This is a kingdom that's about to happen. You're going to rule. But Jesus is saying, yeah, but there's something that you don't know about. I'm going to build this. And it's going to be something that's mine. And right there in that moment, Jesus reveals something about God's great love story and God's nature. He reveals something there that there's much more to come. And he announced our presence in the future. You know, 2,000 years later, here we are, and we're actually part of God's great love story. And isn't that amazing? Jesus, once again, not only validates who he claims to be, but also everything he promises, he delivers. And if you don't believe that, just look around you this morning. We're the proof. Here we are, sitting here worshiping a risen Savior. And look at how he closes this conversation. He says, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. No matter what the obstacle, no matter what the culture, Jesus says, nothing will stop what I'm about to introduce, what I'm about to launch in this world. And here we are. We are the church. And literally, one-third of the world's population today is worshiping a risen Savior. Millions and millions of people around the world are worshiping Christ because he said, now is not the time for the kingdom. Now is the time for the church. And nothing is going to stop it. And isn't that what has happened? If you know anything about church history, it's amazing. The church has survived so many obstacles. You know, it has survived persecution. It's even survived prosperity, idealism, education. It's even survived some preachers out there, believe me. Nothing is going to stop it. Everything else will come and go. But the church lives on. You know why? Because Jesus says, I will establish my church, and there is nothing anyone or anything can do to stop it. Now, I'm curious. How many of you today are aware that you are fulfilling a prophecy that was declared by Jesus some 2,000 years ago just by attending church? Just by attending worship? Have you ever thought of it that way? That you are fulfilling prophecy? If you're like me, you know, you've been going to church all your life and you've never really thought about it that way. You've never really thought, you know, I'm the fulfillment of something Jesus proclaimed 2,000 years ago. Maybe you never thought of that. But you have been involved in part of the love story of redemption. And I want to tell you that this is just as significant as what happened to Abraham or what happened to Moses or David or even the nation of Israel. It's just as significant part of this story as the day angel came to Mary and gave her the news of Jesus. We are just an important part as any part of the story is. It's a marvelous love story of redemption. Because we are the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you know what's unique about the church that sets it apart from anything else in any part of history? And the Apostle Paul, he runs with this a little later on. Jesus says, you know what's going to make the church different from any family or any kingdom or any organization or anything else that's ever put together? He says, the church is actually going to be my body, which had to be very confusing for them. It's not going to be, he says, just a bunch of people running around. It's going to be people that are representing me. There's going to be this thing that when the people who accept Christ come together and function as they were gifted, something special is going to happen. And it's the closest that you will ever get to seeing this side of heaven on this earth. And you think about that. There's times in worship service where we're moved. I don't know about you, but there are certain songs when we sing those. You know, I'm being up here in front, I just have to stop singing and listen to you as we worship our Heavenly Father because it just moves my very soul. There are those moments where I get those goosebumps and I know that the presence of the Lord is here. And it's because we are the church. We are worshiping together. I've had people that have visited here and still, some that are still here actually, and they tell me, man, I just don't know what it is, but I felt something while I was within that church today. And I know what it is, and you know what it is. It's the body of Christ coming together in the presence of the Lord. Because when the body of Christ comes together and functions the way that God intended it to function, and as the church begins to start looking like the church, it's the closest you will ever get to standing in the presence of Jesus until he physically returns. Little did they know, these disciples, as they stood there and as they listened to Jesus some 2,000 years ago, that there would come a day when everything that Jesus talked about would come to pass. And here we, you and I, are invited to be a part of that. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? It's amazing to me. I hope it's amazing to you. So where does that leave us? You know, Abraham, we know the story of Abraham. Abraham, he knew what to do to follow God. Moses and the Israelites, they knew what to do to follow the will of the Lord. They had a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. David, he understood the law was clear. You know, he knew that you had to follow God, that there was a time to repent, there was a time to mourn, and there was a time to rejoice. And even when Jesus walked the earth, you know, if you were part of that crowd, you understood that you would cast your nets down and just follow him and be in his presence. But what about now? What about now? We've been waiting and waiting and waiting for Jesus to return and the time of his kingdom to be here. What about us? What about now? What do we do? Let me just say this morning. God is no less active today than when he was in the Old Testament or when he was in the time that Jesus has walked the face of this earth. He is just as interested in this age as he was in ages past because we are a part of his story. That story, it continues today. But here's the thing that we need to be aware of. It won't last forever. Jesus makes it clear in the final chapter and verses of Matthew that our patience and our waiting should be filled with purpose while we are here on this earth. And maybe you've read this story and you know what this is. Well, they call it the Great Commission. And Jesus, as he begins to get ready to ascend to heaven, he brings all of his disciples together on the side of this mountain. And he makes this one proclamation. And he says it in this way, verse 18. He says, Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." In other words, my words carry value. Our Heavenly Father has given me the power to make a proclamation that is going to be a command that you must follow. He has that kind of authority. But it's amazing to me as we read this. It doesn't read so much as a command as it reads as an invitation to us. Jesus is saying, yes, my words hold value, but I want to make to you an invitation. Verse 19, he says it this way. He says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I am with you." This is the promise. "Surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Now, what's he talking about, very end of the age? He's saying, hey, this isn't over. This movement that was started, this chapter in God's great love story, is just as important as the chapter on Abraham, as the chapter of Moses, the one of David. This is another chapter, and you and I get to be a part of that. And do you know what the promise is here? The promise is that for men and women who are serious about their faith, men and women who are serious about following Christ's commands, to the point of being serious as the saints in the past, God himself will be in the midst of that endeavor that you and I will assume. Jesus says, when you pursue what I have commanded you to do, I will be with you till the end of the age. Now, I don't know if you know this or not, but do you know why so many churches in America today are closing their doors? And so many churches, as you drive by and you look around at the parking lot and there's hardly anyone there, and you wonder, what in the world is going on here? You know, can I tell you why that's happening? It's because they forgot that. They forgot about the make part. They're not doing this. They forgot about making disciples. And it has become something that they do out of habit or do because they enjoy being in each other's company. They forgot about making. They forgot about the kingdom. They forgot about this invitation. And if you're here today and you say, yeah, my Christian life is just kind of flat, it's just kind of boring, then it's because you're not doing what God has left you here to do. You're not making followers. Why should God show up and do anything in you and for you if you aren't willing to step up and be a part of what he has commissioned us to do right here in his kingdom on earth? And I would say today that being patient is great. Waiting is okay. We can tolerate waiting. But God has given us a spot in this great love story of his. And it's an invitation, if you will. And he shows up when men and women have faith and the dedication to be passionate about being part of this great commission. It's the kind of people that God was with in Abraham's day, that God was with in Moses' day and in David's day. And it's the same kind of people he is with today. And if we don't want to bring people into the kingdom and embrace this, then we are going to miss our chance to be a part of this great story and a part of this next chapter and a part of what God has called us to do. And this is so hard for us to see, but this age, this generation that we live in now, it will come to an end. Folks, I'm telling you, our time is limited. I don't know if anybody ever listens to TED Talks or not, but I listened to a TED Talk. And this guy actually had a ruler that's 3 foot long. He says the average lifespan is 72 years. Some of us live longer than that, some of us shorter. But he said the average lifespan is 72 years. And he says, you know, if you're 35, you're about right here in the middle. If you're 50, you're right here. But if you're over 50, you're right here. This will come to an end. Our lives will end here on earth. And our opportunity to serve our Christ and to serve our God will come to an end. And when it does, we're going to wish that we've been about the thing that God had left us here to do, that God had set for us to do. Because after that, we're going to be missing out. Yes, I wish He'd come back soon. And yes, I wish God would clean up the mess. And I can't wait till He gets rid of sin and pain and sorrow and death. I'm looking forward to that day. But until that day, He has left us, the church, with some things to do. And a part of the story that we're to interact with. And Peter, he says it best, and it doesn't get much clearer than this. 2 Peter 3:9. Peter writes this. He says, "The Lord is not slow in keeping His promises, some would understand slowness. Instead, He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. And so not only do we wait, but God waits. He waits and He calls on us, the body of Christ, to be His presence and to make disciples of all nations, knowing that someday this age is going to come to an end. And when it does, wouldn't it be great to have been part of what God was doing right here on earth and what God has called you to do? Now, I want to be honest. This might bother some of you. You may be thinking, well, oh, Tony, this sounds like more work than I have time for. You know, we have a good church. Why are we going to push it any harder? Well, I'll tell you why. Because I, and hopefully you, we believe all this. We believe every bit of this. We believe that there's heaven. We believe that there's a hell. We believe that there's a Savior, and He is risen from the dead, and He has provided a way out of our sin. And we are called to be His church. And this church age, this chapter that we're living in now, it's going to come to an end someday. And we may be only a paragraph, or we may be only a page away from that. We don't know. But that last great chapter of His love story for us, it's going to come to an end. And meanwhile, we wait. And we wait patiently. But we're to wait proactively. And while we wait, we're to make disciples. Because one day, we're all going to stand before our Heavenly Father. And we're going to give an account of our lives and our interaction as His church. And I hope on that day we can say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be a part of Your great love story. I'm going to ask our musicians to come forward this morning to lead us in a closing prayer, but I want to, or a closing song, but I want to pray for us as they're doing that. So if you would, just pray with me this morning. Father God, we know that You have called us to be more than just people that come to church. You have called us to be Your church. Father, to be the hands and feet of Jesus, to help others see the love that Jesus has, and to point them in that direction, allowing the Holy Spirit to move them, so that they will know the peace that we have with You. Father, sometimes we don't respond to that well. Sometimes we get caught up in this life. We get caught up in the things of this life. Father, help us to be aware that all that will pass. All that will come to an end one day. Have us to be aware that this is an invitation for us to be a part of something bigger. Something more than just this fleeting life that we have here on earth. Father, I ask that You would just open our hearts and open our minds. That You would give us those opportunities that we might share Christ with others. That our life might reflect that of a follower of Jesus. And that, Father, others would come to know Christ. In the meantime, Father, we wait. We wait patiently. But, Father, we're eager for Your return. So, Lord, in this moment, we just ask that You have us to be Your servants. Have us to be Your servants and have us to serve You. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand this morning as we sing our closing song.
Oh, pray for those.